we can learn a lot about heaven, about what to expect by looking at God. Heaven is God's home and reflects Him. Our last time together, we looked at what theologians call general revelation. What can we know about God by observing His creation? I pulled out 2 points, beauty and precision. God is the author of great beauty in His creation. You've seen some of the pictures taken from space, both of our planet and the space beyond. You can't help but be overcome by the beauty of creation. I think God has pulled out all the stops when He created heaven. It is beautiful beyond all imagination. The precision of the working of our universe is an indication that heaven will also be totally synchronized and will work without any glitches or problems. We've been having Zoom meetings with a few people on Thursday afternoons. We call it Coffee with Len and Iona. And some of our people, well, they've never used Zoom before, so I call them a couple of days in advance, and we work our way through it, help them to familiarize, and then give it a test run. Most times, we get it to work, but sometimes, no matter what we do, it just won't work. Makes me think of Murphy's Law. You know that one, don't you? If something can go wrong, it will. Murphy's Law will have no relevance at all in heaven. Well, let's move on to special revelation. What can we learn about God from the pages of the Bible? In Psalm 90, verse 2, we read these words, "Before the mountains were born, or you brought forth the earth and the world, from everlasting to everlasting, you are God." This speaks of the infinity of God. You want to drive yourself crazy? Try this. Try to wrap your mind around the concept of infinity. Everything in creation is finite. That is, it has a beginning and it has an end. Every event in heaven or in history has a before and an after. What was society like before the First World War? What has it been like after? Every area has its edges. This little green planet orbiting in space around the sun has edges. There are some parts of the universe that are Earth and a whole bunch of other parts that aren't Earth. On a clear night, lay on your back and look up at the stars and try to imagine yourself able to see it all. What is there after we have reached the boundaries, the edges? Everything in this universe is finite with beginnings and endings. But heaven, like God, is without end. I enjoy going to Mexico in the winter to escape Saskatchewan winters. I love the sunshine and the good food and walking along the beach. But there is something I know. Each vacation will come to an end. I will have to return to frigid Saskatoon, but heaven won't ever end. It is infinite. Let that thought wash over you for a while. What else can we expect to find in heaven? In his first letter, the Apostle John said simply this, God is love. Not that he is loving, oh, he is, but that the essence of who he is love. Everything is better and more enjoyable when it's given in love. I would much rather eat a ham sandwich on stale bread if Iona gives it to me than eat a most succulent, sumptuous, 5-star restaurant meal eaten alone or with somebody who just doesn't care about me. God is love, and He has chosen to love me. And that love is way more than just words. He showed it. I read somewhere, I can't remember where, someone says, I asked God how much He loved me, and He stretched out His arms and said, I love you this much. And then He died for me. Heaven is God's love gift to us. Every square centimeter of heaven will be saturated with the love of God. Let's move on. God is just. Hear these words from Deuteronomy chapter 32, verse 4. He is the rock. His works are perfect, and all his ways are just. A faithful God who does no wrong, upright and just is he. I think one of the first things that we learn how to say when we are children is this: it's not fair. You've said it. I've said it. We all have said it. We all have an innate sense of justice, of what is fair and what isn't. It isn't fair for someone to steal from another person, and it's not fair for a person to take another's life, and it isn't fair or right for someone to tell lies about another. Some things are fair, while some things are decidedly unfair. God is totally and completely fair. He is just. There's another word that we need to introduce here, and that, well, without it, none of us would ever be able to dream of going to heaven. That word is grace. Do I deserve to go to heaven? Have I lived such a sinless and perfect life that heaven is just what I have earned, what I deserve? Absolutely not. I've sinned. I will continue to sin, whether it is in thought or word or deed. But because some 45 years ago, I willingly confessed my sins and asked Jesus to forgive me, I have been assured a place in heaven. I often use hotels.com to make reservations, but I have to confess that before I check in, I have a few moments of trepidation. Has the reservation really been made? Or will I arrive and be told that, well, there's no reservation in my name? Heaven's reservation system is absolutely perfect. There are no mistakes possible. No one can hack into it and remove my reservation, my name. And the reservation has been paid for in advance with the blood of Jesus. Because heaven is a place of complete and perfect justice, there are a few things that there won't be in heaven. We won't need them. There won't be any policemen walking around heaven. Why would we need police in a place where it is populated by people who have been forgiven and cleansed of all unrighteousness? There won't be any courts, because we will all be in a place where each of us will be perfectly loving our neighbors in the same way we love ourselves. There also won't be any need for military. God has already defeated once and for all the only real enemy we've ever had, the devil. And we will have no need to defend ourselves or the mansions that God has designed and built for us. One last point. God is wise. Listen to Paul's words of wonder at the wisdom of God in Romans 11 and 33. Oh, the depth of the riches of the wisdom and the knowledge of God. How unsearchable his judgments and his paths beyond tracing out. Heaven will reflect the wisdom of God. Heaven, as I perceive it and experience it, may be somewhat different than how you perceive and experience heaven. God, in his great wisdom, knows how I have been made. He knows what I've experienced life, and what will give me the greatest joy and pleasure. Based on that reasoning, there may very well be pickleball in heaven. Now, don't hold me to that. I used to just love playing golf when I was younger. Any opportunity to get on the golf course, I'd be there. I'd jump on it. But now, well, maybe it has to do with my age and the fact that I don't have the energy that I used to have. But I hardly ever play golf anymore. For the last few years, I have played one round of golf a year. Maybe the same thing will happen when I enter heaven, and pickleball just won't be that important to me anymore. In 1 Corinthians 13, Paul said that when he was a child, he thought as a child, and he reasoned as a child. But when he grew up, he put away childish things. Maybe pickleball will be one of those childish things that I will have to, I've just forgotten. God's wisdom will mean that there just isn't anything that could possibly be in heaven that would make me enjoy it more. It will be totally and completely perfect. Through general and special revelation, we have seen that God is a God of beauty and precision, that he is love, that he is just, that he is wise, and each of these will be reflected in heaven. Heaven really is a wonderful place. Instead of praying today, I want you to allow me to pronounce the benediction of the high priest Aaron upon us. So receive this benediction. Now may the Lord bless you and the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift his countenance unto you and give you peace, both now and forever and forever. Amen.